we have a packed show on the urban debate tonight. Tonight we begin with a discussion about a shocking story that's unfolded in the last couple of days. A story about how national security of this country was compromised. A story about a decorated cop who turned out to be friends of terrorists in Kashmir. Deputy Superintendent of Police, Davinder Singh, who was arrested while ferrying two Hizbul Mujahideen terrorists, has now allegedly admitted that he took 12 lakh rupees from these terrorists to take them from Kashmir to New Delhi. Intelligence sources say the terrorists plan to carry out attacks on Republic Day. The focus is not the terror plot. The focus tonight is how come a cop was helping them? How come a cop got away with this for so long? How come a cop took money and was helping terrorists in Jammu and Kashmir? Who is this man? And the number of times we may have ignored the red flags, the warning signs about this cop. Davinder Singh, on 10th of January, his conversation with district commander of Hizbul Mujahideen was intercepted. Now, this is how he was caught. The entire operation was actually monitored by the DIG of South Kashmir. On 11th of Jan, DSP Davinder Singh's car was intercepted based on specific intelligence. His car was intercepted at Jammu and Kashmir's Kulgaon area. DSP Davinder Singh was in that car with two terrorists. Now, as he was caught, police carried out raids at various places, including his residence. And from the car, as well as from his residence, a significant amount of ammunition, including an AK rifle, was seized. What worries me, viewers, is how DSP Davinder Singh actually managed to stay off the radar while being in very, very sensitive positions and postings and sensitive locations in Kashmir, while actually being part of counter-insurgency teams, while actually being part of the counter-terrorism teams, while actually being part of the anti-hijacking team linked to the Srinagar airport. This man today has been caught as a friend of terrorists. Now, there were other red flags that were actually ignored. There was red flag number one. An internal inquiry had found him selling contraband. And the move to dismiss him at that point of time was actually stalled. He was let go. Example number two. He was accused of extortion when he was posted in Budgam. At that point of time, when obviously a departmental probe took place, he was sent back to police lines. But nothing happened. Red flag number three. He was accused of wrongdoing in Pulwama. And at that point of time, rather than throwing him out of the force, he was transferred to the anti-hijacking unit. Red flag number four, he was actually named by Afzal Guru in a letter. And that role was never probed in detail. Now, for each of these examples, we'll take you through the details over the course of next 50 minutes. But let's discuss what this really means and how is it possible that we ignored all of these warning signs. Let's say good evening to our panelists. Anuradha Bhasin, executive editor of Kashmir Times, joins us from Jammu this evening. Lieutenant General Satish Dua, former corps commander in Kashmir. He retired as the chief of integrated defense staff. Maruf Raza, strategic affairs expert and consulting editor to the Times Network. Mr. B.L. Vora, former DGP, and our managing editor, Vinay Tiwari, joining me in our Miranau studios. And Vinay, I want to start with you, actually, because, you know, you've also now researched in detail about this man, this policeman, and the number of times the system seems to have overlooked what he could be doing.
Yes, and I think one of the things that worries me more in this case is not what's actually coming out, but what's possibly being hidden. And I think in more than one terror attack, especially the headline-grabbing terror attacks that we've seen in India, while we've been very good at investigating perhaps the external link, we've been lax and sometimes even diligent, ignorant of probing sometimes the internal link. Now, one of the narratives that is coming out of J&K, which is logically sometimes correct, but in this case doesn't seem to be so, as at least till now, there is a concept which the SOG or the other anti-terrorist units in the police use, which is of somebody being a double agent. But in this case, this officer's role right from the time he joined as a sub-inspector in 1990 till now has had many, many red flags. And I suppose and I suspect that it's not just about this officer, but the supervisory officers who control and handle important officers, their role is also a little suspect in this case, because clearly there have been more than one instance where this officer has done many things. The Afzal Guru letter that you mentioned, in fact, Afzal Guru's case, he was not mentioned once but twice in that letter. There was once, of course, Afzal Guru writing a letter to his lawyer saying that he made me the points person to ferry one of the people who got killed in that attack. But he also tells his interrogators, Afzal Guru had told his interrogators, that this officer was the one who interrogated him and tortured him the most.
Yes.
In fact, Davinder Singh's reputation in the valley is of somebody who was an ace interrogator. This was something he used to boast about, that any officer, any terrorist that I interrogate and comes out clean has to be a clean person because I'm the best. Now, clearly, Davinder Singh, who Davinder Singh is more than what we've heard. There is clearly something much more to this officer, but it's not coming out. But I strongly believe that your war against terror or your war against insurgency needs to also look inwards. Maybe one oddball black sheep, but those oddball black sheep can prove to be very, very critical in sensitive times.
Yes, in fact, because you also mentioned the letter by Afzal Guru, this is an excerpt as for what has been published by the print. And Afzal Guru in this letter says, then they took me to Humama STF camp, where DSP Davinder Singh also tortured me. One of his torture inspector, as they called him, Shanti Singh, electrified me naked for 3 hours and made me drink water while giving electric shocks through telephone instrument. Here is the operative part. Ultimately, I accepted to pay them 10 lakh rupees, for which my family sold the gold of my wife. Even after this, they could manage only 80,000 rupees. Then they took the scooter too, which was just 2 to 3 months old, which I bought for 24,000 rupees. Thus, after getting 1 lakh rupees, they let me free. Now, and he goes on to obviously paint a sympathetic picture for himself and how broke he is. But the fact being that he was a dirty cop for a long time, and this lead and these allegations were perhaps they were probed, and or they were probed, and at some point somebody came in and said, let it be. Maruf, what's your own reading of this? How is it that the man who's been, you know, in controversies every few years has still been in the system and been part of crucial teams?
Well, you know, historically, people who have these kind of double personalities or have dubious intentions, one thing they have is very good PR skills. And therefore, they are able to get around all those around them and project an image about them as to their superiors, as somebody who is a reliable colleague and who can deliver again and again, to their juniors, as somebody who is more loyal to the crown than anybody else. But I think there are one or two other aspects that we need to touch upon. One is that DSP Singh has, from what I've just read, has four properties in Jammu and Kashmir. So he has two houses in Srinagar, one house in Thral, one house in Jammu. Now, unless those houses are shacks, obviously he's been doing quite well for some time. And any superior officer, if he knew about the assets he had, and having four houses is not normally something that a police officer and an honest police officer can boast about. So where did he get those from? Where were the assets coming in? Unless he's traditionally a landlord or what have you. The second thing about him, which seems very unusual, is that he was repeatedly trusted with some of the most sensitive appointments. You've talked about all the red flags, but most recently, the delegation of foreign envoys that was there in Srinagar, there is a photograph available on the net where he's standing with them. Now, if the man had links with terrorists and wanted to show India in bad light, he could have done anything. Please remember that some of the most trusted police personnel which were providing protection to Mrs. Gandhi, finally assassinated her. This is the same kind of story that comes out again and again, that it is not necessarily that you should be looking for people with links to terrorists only in one community. What you are least suspicious about could be the most important link the terrorists have with the organization. And the one difference, in general, Dua will bear me out on that, because having been co-commander and with extensive experience in J&K, while the military still operates within the civilian populace in insurgency areas, the ability or the historical links of the military with the civilian population and the administration is still very, very officious. Whereas the police is the go-between the military and the civilian population, and therefore neither lives in secluded cantonments, neither operates completely in a structured environment like the military and the army does, but they have a lot of flexibility in terms of getting and reaching out to those terrorist groups with links. And I'm not for a moment casting aspersions on the intentions and capabilities of the Jammu and Kashmir Police, which I'm told has over the years matured into a first-class anti-terrorism force. But there are elements there which are not bound by the barbed wire of cantonments, and therefore they are able to engage with a host terrorist, like in this case, these guys stayed at his house, he was driving them down. Two of them had prices of 15 to 20 lakhs on their head.
Yes, and imagine
now, obviously,
that, you know, Malu.
This guy was playing the big game. And I don't think it is just 12 lakhs.
Yes, you know, the point that you were making, exactly that. The reward, yep, on these guys was bigger than what was being paid to this cop. So either he's been in this for the long haul, and
absolutely,
he can't, frequently gets paid, which is why the 20 lakh wasn't a bigger drive for him, and the 12 lakh was because he's part of the system. And, you know, the latest PTI report also says that he had ferried the same guy, Naveed Babu, even last year. So he had been helping one of the biggest terrorists right now, Hizbul terrorists in Kashmir. He had been helping him at least the last 1 year. Now, Maruf, if I can just take that point across to General Dua. General Dua, for people outside of Jammu and Kashmir to understand the gravity of this, the fact that this was a man who was part of counter-insurgency operations and anti-hijacking teams just makes it a lot more concerning. How is he working in such close quarters and still getting away? Is there no oversight of these team members, you know, people who become part of such important operations?
I totally agree with you that somebody who's working in the system, now just as Maruf said, while JNK Police has become a very fine operational force over the years, we must also remember that people have to cultivate sources, so they come in contact with a lot of other side. When, as we heard earlier, he was talking about the double agent issue. The point is, when someone tries to cultivate sources, there is a lot of interaction with the other side, and some of these guys actually have gone astray. He obviously is one of them. There were several red flags, so many incidents, several charges against him over the years. But I would also put it this way, that it is his own force that has tracked him down, that has eventually nabbed him also very promptly when the DSP, the DIG, has moved personally without even full protection, without full arrangements, because he really wanted to nab him at. So the point I'd like to make is true that this man has somehow, like Maruf said, managed to win trust again and again. Maybe he has good PR skills, etc. But it is very heartening to note that the same system has actually caught him. About that photograph with the foreign envoys, I'm given to understand that he was in the airport security, so it's bound to happen that he would be moving around them, and then there would be a couple of pictures like that. essentially, the last sentence I would like to say, when we have such forces or such agencies which work in close proximity to such dynamics, we should also have a system to carry out some checks and balances, track the suspicious activities, and then there should be system should be strong enough or robust enough to be able to nab them and take corrective action.
Yes, you know, and that's exactly what I'm trying to understand. Isn't there already a system, General Dua, for crucial postings and places?
Yes.
Especially,
yes.
You know, in Kashmir, who gets deputed there? What is their background? There has to be a more exhaustive background check where this needs to pop up, that he was part of an inquiry where there was a narcotics seizure and he sold that contraband, that he was named by one of the biggest terrorists that our country has seen, which is Afzal Guru, and the writings about him were not very flattering. And there have been four different instances that have come out. Shouldn't this pop up in a background check before we post him for airport security or even in Pulwama or Budgam or Shopian?
I agree with you. This should have popped up. Like I'm repeating, at the expense of repeating myself to what Maru said, somehow he's managed to win back that trust again. The inquiry that took place after Afzal Guru naming him eventually managed to get it closed, or whatever has happened. One is not privy to that. But yes, you are right. Somewhere, some lapse has certainly occurred, that this officer has been posted in a very sensitive appointment after, despite all these improprieties taking place. So I'm sure the department will conduct its inquiry and the needful will be done. But yes, we have to be more diligent in making sure that we post the right people to the right place.
Yes, because like Vinay was also pointing out, I mean, you can't have enemies within your own camp. You can't have people who are actually compromising the security, compromising our own operations, and helping the other side. Now, another person, if I can come to you on one very other interesting aspect that I noticed here, that one of the guys who was caught with him, one of the terrorists who was caught with him, was also earlier in the police force, and he actually went missing and he ran away in 2017, and he had taken about 4 guns with him. So there was ammunition and guns that were missing when he just vanished in 2017. There has been a connect between those from the forces who've perhaps gone to the other side and people who are working within the force still. Is that something that needs to be looked into in much more depth?
I think the entire case needs to be looked into in much more depth. The truth needs to be to emerge, and our quest should be for the truth, howsoever uncomfortable it is. You know, when you say that Davinder Singh was some kind of a very powerful man, he had a very good PR, this is not a very palatable argument. This man has had a checkered history right since 2000. In 2000, he was known for many torture cases, and he was even nicknamed Torture Singh in Kashmir. Thereafter, you know, there have been several inquiries against him. The contraband case you mentioned, several extortion cases. The sessions judge once held him guilty of crime and asked the police to take action. The police did not take action. This is not about PR. There is something seriously wrong within the system, or there is a tacit complicity at some level at the top. And this is being covered up. And that is something I'm not okay with. The other damning thing, I mean, this particular case has a lot of similarity with the Afzal Guru case. Because Afzal Guru pointed out that he was, Davinder Singh was with him when he came to Delhi. And it wasn't just a case of accompanying him. He said that he was tortured and coerced into working for him. So Afzal Guru, according to that letter, it cannot be taken on face value. But the problem is that it was never investigated. It was in the public domain, it was talked about, but it was treated in the official circles like a figment of imagination. So Afzal Guru was actually taking orders from him. So the question that needs to be asked is, who was taking orders from whom, even in this case? The Naveed Babu, or whatever his
yes,
name is,
yes.
A deserter from police who decamped with the rifles and became a militant, was obviously a junior to Davinder Singh in the police. So I don't, you know, it seems a little absurd that he was offering him money and he was giving him money. There's something seriously wrong, and until we investigate, it should we should not jump to conclusions. I think there are questions that remain unanswered. And this is not the first case where a policeman's complicity has been found in terror cases. It has been found earlier with a lot of STF officers have been found to be involved, or there have been shady roles. And not just police officers, even in the other security agencies. The third thing that I would like to say is that this entire counterinsurgency system, there is something very murky about the way the funding is not made accountable. There are unlimited funds coming and they are not being accounted for. Where are they going? Where are they being spent on? I think we need to do some, there needs to be some transparency, some kind of a public accounting on that front. If you remember the Major Avtar Singh case, Major Avtar Singh was accused of several human rights violations and of coercing many surrendered militants. And in one of his interviews at a time that he was held, in one of his media interviews, he spoke about that if I speak, I will expose several other people. You know, these kind of things. Now that this case has been revealed, I think we need to investigate it much, much more deeply.
Oh, yes, absolutely. And, you know, many layers that need to be seen right now. I will go across to Mr. Vora in just a bit. But, Maruf, you wanted to make a point before I go ahead?
Yeah, I think the speaker, Ms. Anuradha, has just made some very strong points. And all of them are valid, except the fact is that, you know, the point I was making about PR skills, and General Dua also sort of went along with it. The fact is that public relations skills are not just about putting out huge splashy headlines on in the print media or holding big conferences or whatever else. Public relations skills are also about your being able to engage with individuals,
no,
both in
I
authority and your colleagues, with a level of smoothness that gets them to overlook your other darker side. And that is the point I was referring to, that DSP Singh and so many others have a capacity to keep the lid on their activity by kind of deflecting attention or more detailed investigation into some of their acts by always coming up with a kind of alibi or a situation alert to say, sir, abhi main us cheez mein ja raha hun, thoda busy hun, I will come back and talk about it. And you know, because of the pace of things in J&K in particular, a lot of things get sidelined by saying, okay, let me deal with the immediate crisis than trying to investigate this guy. But the broader point that was being made, I'm completely on board with it in terms of the funding that goes into such operations. But let me tell you, and this I would like to be contradicted on this by any of the speakers, there is a hell of a lot of money that goes into intelligence-related activity, not just in J&K, but in other border states and in some other countries abroad, because these kind of funds are never made public, whether the Indian government or any other major government, or even if you take the United States, which is the model of democracy for a lot of people. But how the investigating agencies and CIA and others operate with massive funding, which is never made public. So I don't think you can make a case out on the basis of DSP Singh's example that funding should be made public. But I think a lot more of the government's initiative hinges on how they fund things and how they get information and how they keep people humored with fundings. And I don't think we're going to get very far with our demand for that. What we really need to do is, and that's a point, Tanvi, you made, not any of the speakers, that we need to get more alert. And from time to time, when people move from one sensitive appointment to another, it is a good case as a start point that their credentials must be reinvestigated and their links in public and private life should be investigated quietly. And it is not just the job of intelligence agencies and others to only investigate the links that politicians or anti-India separatists have, but all people in sensitive appointment, their chapters must be reopened all over again to check thus far how have they come, how are they getting around, and was there any suspicious activity they took on before they went on to, as General Dua brought out, to airport security. And what point I was making is that a person like him who was floating around the dignitaries,
yes,
and if he had terrorist links, you don't need to take terrorists all the way to Delhi for 26 January.
Just get
you
them to the airport.
You could have harmed some of the diplomats and you'll have more global headlines there than doing a few bomb blasts in the Republic Day parade.
Oh, yes, absolutely. And you know, on one hand, he's a man who's been given an award, a gallantry award by the Jammu and Kashmir Police. Like Anuradha was pointing out, he's actually known and famous and very reputed for his interrogation and torture skills. And he still has gotten away repeatedly with a lot of stuff that dirty cops should not be getting away with. And now we've come to a point where his terror links have begun to emerge. And he's probably still, you know, scraping at the top. We don't know what else lies down there. Just to, for our viewers to know, Davinder Singh joined as a sub-inspector of Jammu and Kashmir Police in 1990. In 94, he got inducted in the Special Operations Group, SOG as it is known as, in Jammu and Kashmir. Very quickly, because of the kind of work he was doing, impressing his seniors, very quickly he was actually promoted to the post of inspector. In 2001, DSP, he became the DSP of Budgam's Special Operation Group. Budgam is another of those very sensitive zones. 2003, he was part of the UN Peacekeeping Force. In Kosovo, 2018, he was awarded a gallantry medal by the Jammu and Kashmir Police. Mr. Vora, it seems the way, you know, and you and I have had many debates of how cops are let off easily when there are allegations and grave allegations against them in rest of the country, and they're simply suspended or transferred, and there is one farcical departmental inquiry and nothing comes of it. It seems as if the same is happening in Jammu and Kashmir Police, and we can't afford to do that when you're fighting terrorism and militancy.
I don't think he'll be let off lightly. He's already being booked as a terrorist. I'm sure he would not only lose his job, he will go to jail. There's no doubt about it. Now, talking of this person, there are a few other elements also, according to me. One connection could be the person who was traveling with him was a police constable who had run away in 2017 with four guns. So there's some police connection also. This man, Naveed Babu, I think, who was the now second in command of Hizbul Mujahideen there. So this is one connection. And policemen do have connections. They keep connections later on also. This could be one. Money alone, I don't think, at least personally, I think is important. But maybe there is something more also, which investigators would find out and know. Thirdly, there are internal checks and balances. There's no doubt about it. We find black sheep everywhere. Even in CBI, we find. I've served in the Northeast as DGP, Manipur and Tripura. There also, wherever there are such situations, there are locals who, sometimes they're relatives, sometimes they're friends. That angle also works with these people. Now, question is, why was he at Srinagar airport? Well, point is that somewhere you have to post people, and since he was not under scanner for anything else perhaps at the moment, so that is why he was posted there, but that's a risky place. Funding, public funding, yes, a lot of funds are spent, everybody knows it, and everybody spends it, all agencies spend it internationally, nationally, and they can't be made public for obvious reasons. Now, the main thing here is that internal checks will have to be stronger now, and I'm sure agencies are working on that. And I have a feeling that much more will come out of this lone case now, which has come to light. Because many other policemen have also deserted, and unless they get protection of local police, sometimes it is not really possible to achieve something as far as the terrorists are concerned. So I think taking the entire view, I think there's nothing new. These things do happen, but checks have to be kept and stringent punishment has to be given. Vigilance has to be kept. As they say, you have to pay eternal price. for peace, whatever.
Mr. Vora, I'm sorry. I know you're saying it, and you probably have a lot more experience.
Bad thing happened, but it's good. It's good that happened.
No, you know, you're saying you probably have a lot more experience, so maybe you're not surprised, but I am very, very surprised. I'm shocked, and I'm extremely concerned about the fact that this man was named by a terrorist like Afzal Guru, by the man who carried out the attack on India's parliament, has still managed to stay within the force, insensitive roles, insensitive places in Kashmir for 18 long years since then. And that cannot be acceptable. Vinay, I don't understand this.
That is why he must be treated as a terrorist.
Which is now, 18 years later, we don't know what else has happened, you know, since then. And what was his role to begin with? We don't know what was his role. Nobody bothered to follow that lead, Vinay. How can that be?
Look, we have General Dua and we have Major Maruf, both of who understand certain things very
failure.
Well.
It's a failure.
For the benefit of the viewers, let me explain. Look, this man joined one of the two lower rung entry forces in the police, which is a sub-inspector. A sub-inspector who then graduates or gets promoted to DYSP is actually the front-end person of an operational unit. SSPs and above are actually supervisory officers in many ways, but a DYSP is actually the boots on the ground. Now, I can completely imagine the police force, obviously, the question number one, is J&K police a great force? It is. It's probably the most weather-beaten and the most adept to CI operation force in the country, no doubt about that. Question number two, can there be just few black sheep? Not everyone is bad. Yes, of course, there can be few black sheep. But then comes the bigger question. You can be pardoned or excused for a situation where you are caught off guard and you do not have prior knowledge. In fact, parliament attack was perhaps one of the biggest terror attacks that had happened in India till 2001. Before that, we had terror attacks, but this was the seat of Indian democracy. No matter how random the charge, if Afzal Guru, the main accused who was ultimately convicted and hanged, if he writes a letter to his lawyer where he says, this man made me the points, he was the points person for transporting X individual from point A to point Z, it should have been investigated. That investigation was obviously not done as seriously. Supervisory officer's role is to be alert on red flags. Now, in this individual's case, there have been more than one red flag. There's not just one red flag. So my worry and my concern is not about the fact, and I'm not really very happy about the fact that he's been caught now and he'll be tried and put in jail. Of course, he should. My worry is, it's been a while since this fellow should have been on the radar. Obviously, there have been attempts, and I can almost guarantee you that there are supervisory officers who had something to do in protecting him and not allowing the rogue side of him to come out. It cannot happen. In policing, Mr. Vora has been a seasoned cop. He knows it. It is impossible that an SP or a device or a SSP does not know what his DYSPs are up to over such a long period of time. It's impossible. There has to be complicity. There has to be dereliction of duty. Sometimes it could even be criminal in conduct. We don't know that. The investigation will tell. But clearly, there was an attempt made by more than one officer to protect him and to not allow him to be investigated to the level that he should be.
So I'm going to take this point further. And General Dua, if I can come to you and ask a slightly controversial question. Does it happen, and could this be a case where perhaps he was given the long rope and the seniors looked the other way because he was so great at getting interrogations done, because he was famous for the way he tortured terror suspects and got information out of them or got confessions out of them?
I really don't think so. Nobody in his right mind would like to give a long rope intentionally to a wrong guy just because he gets certain things done expeditiously or by using unconventional sort of methods and modus operandi. I don't think so. I mean, having been a man who's commanded troops in such situations, I'll repeat myself. I don't think anybody would do that intentionally. What has happened? Why has he not got caught? As we've been discussing, all of us have been discussing that. Why was he not weeded out earlier? Is something that the departmental inquiry will throw up since it already hasn't. But I would not subscribe to the theory that somebody is intentionally letting off. Yes.
Well, I'm just trying to find all possible reasons for what has just happened and how, you know, this has just fallen through the gaps or has been overlooked, or there is complicity at senior levels as well, which is why this is happening. After all, Anuradha Basin, he had these terrorists staying with him just a few meters away from the 15 core commands and right entire setup. That's how close he was to the biggest army setup that we have in the valley. General Dua, you wanted to say something?
Yes. Since you brought that up, and I've been reading this in several other media reports.
I'll come to you next.
I was in charge of that Badami Bagh cantonment.
Yes.
I was in charge of that Badami Bagh cantonment for a couple of years. All right. Now, just close to that is this Indranagar, Shivpura. Those are very cluttered, densely populated localities. By virtue of their being so close to BB can, really does not let a military oversight into those houses and those dwelling units over there.
Fair enough.
The insinuation that it was so close to the army and we're not.
You got me wrong. The insinuation was not that there was a military intel failure that we couldn't find out. The comment was about how close he was and how, you know, because he has... he's been in these crucial posts and crucial roles and how close he was getting terrorists to such important setups, which was the point. Mr. Vora wanted to come in on the security aspect before I go to Anuradha Basin. Yes.
Right.
To say that in the case of that connection with Afzal Guru, the whole thing was overlooked and there was complicity, I will not agree with that.
Okay.
Maybe there was no evidence, hard evidence which came along, but because there can't be any complicity in such matters. Now, if there had been complicity, even now he would not have been arrested. So I think we should not distrust our police forces and checks and balances agencies. Things do happen ultimately, you know. This is one of those lapses, this is one of those failures which has happened. But I think now they will tighten the screws more. There will be much more vigilance on this account. And I will not be surprised if we get further information now, because some other policemen also, black sheep also may be involved.
No, I don't get that. Mr. Vora, you know, okay. So let's keep the Afzal Guru angle just aside for 1 minute, though. I think that's the biggest thing that we need to look at. That was a terrorist, one of the biggest we've seen, and he named this guy. But even if we keep that aside, even if we simply talk about the fact that there was enough evidence of about him being a dirty cop who sold narcotics that were seized, who was accused of extortion on repeated accounts, who was famous for his torture, who was posted out of Kashmir, Pulwama, and sent to Srinagar because he was accused of wrongdoing in his previous post. And at that point of time, SP Ved, sent him to the Srinagar airport as a punishment posting. How are we giving these roles as punishment postings if somebody's been accused of wrongdoing? Tomorrow, what if he takes 10 lakh rupees as bribe and allows somebody to enter the airport? What happens then? This is Jammu and Kashmir we're talking about.
This can be explained only by the local senior officers. They are the ones who take decisions and surely keeping into account all angles to the situation or to the individual concerned.
Yes.
Now, we sitting here, we cannot really decide or say that they were wrong or something like that. But failure is there. Definitely, there's no doubt about it. I've already conceded that. So, as I said now, this failure will teach us more lessons. And all the agencies are interrogating him. And my feeling is we'll get hold of a few more policemen also who are involved in this.
Yes.
These things do happen sometimes.
Okay.
I mean, it's such a big operation going on there for so many years. So I think we should not paint the entire police department as black.
No, we're not doing that at all. In fact, Vinay just a short while ago said that there is no doubt about the skills and capabilities and of the Jammu and Kashmir police. And we're not saying that all of them are wrong.
Yeah,
but yes, we need to plug these gaps.
They have done a good job.
Before,
they have done a great
Maruf,
job.
Maruf, I'll come to you in just a bit, but Anuradha has been wanting to make a point. Let me go to her first. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'd just like to reiterate that this guy could not have acted on his own. It's very less likely unless he was being patronized by somebody. Either it is a case of absolute inefficiency on the part of not just the police, but the entire state apparatus, and that would mean successive state governments. The most damning charges came in the Afzal Guru case. And what could be worse than the fact, I mean, the parliament attack case is something that changed the entire political narrative of the country. It shook the nation like no other case ever did. And what could be worse than the fact that the man who was accused of or convicted of circumstantial evidence, who was convicted for providing logistics, was hanged. But the man who sent him, who probably may have sent him in the first place, was not only scot-free, he was decorated, he was patronized, he had a long rope. For what? I mean, he wasn't accused in small cases. He was, for heaven's sake, he was accused in the parliament attack case. And so much of laxity, is it deliberate? This really needs an investigation without jumping to conclusions.
Yes, for sure there has to be an in-depth investigation, and why we are saying this repeatedly, and this is what you know, sources seem to be suggesting to us, that even now, even before this operation was carried out and he was nabbed, there was a bit of a tussle within the police department. Now, this too needs to be investigated, but we're given to understand that the ADGP, or one of the top-level officials, actually tried to protect him. It was actually on the, you know, the IG on the other side who said, no, we must go ahead with it and must take action. So there was an internal tussle as well. Maruf, do you agree with what Anuradha is also saying, that he couldn't have survived for this long if there wasn't, you know, complicity perhaps at a senior level?
You see, it's been made, this point has been made today, that it's not fair to put a blanket over the entire J&K police and their three decades of efforts in countering insurgency. Believe me, battling insurgencies, General Dua has a lot of experience of that, but I also have some experience of that, and I've looked at it academically also. It's a very, very tough fight in terms of everything that you are not taught in your initial training comes to play against you when you are in uniform in these areas. But two aspects stick out for me as something that we need to understand. The difference between a policeman, and especially as Vinay has brought out, that when they join at the ground level and rise up to SSP, and the other set of police officers, that the elite that Mr. Grover and others represent, there is a difference. These guys stay on in the state for the rest of their life unless they manage an odd Kosovo posting like Davinder Singh did manage. But they are by and large there, so they have very deep roots, very deep connects with society and the anti-national elements that are hovering around in that society, as in the case of J&K. The second element is that unlike the soldier who does a 2 to 3 year turnover, 2 to 3 year turnover there in any operational area, these guys are there. So there are links that are developed, and these links, if they want to exploit, as DSP Singh did, they go ahead and exploit. But I think the point that Anuradha has made, and it is a very important point, that we have to really look at how he was getting away with it again and again. And this is where I made the initial point that both the expeditious nature of operations that are constantly happening, the nature of his personality of telling his superiors that, sir, I've solved this problem of yours and I'm going on to the next problem, gets them to deflect some kind of a focus from the allegations that hang on his head. But the real challenge now is going to be to make sure that you only pinpoint the blame to the people who were really supporting and encouraging him to be in the system, and not cast your net so wide that even good guys get roped in because of an indirect assumption that they were having links with him because they were his professional colleagues. And this can be very demoralizing to a force and unnerving to people who were engaged with him for operational work. Yes. But today might feel that their credentials are suspect. And we have to be very careful about that. So it's not going to be an easy job for the police establishment in J&K to get this right.
Yes, absolutely. But, you know, I think that the point that all of our panelists have made tonight is that there has to be a larger and a deeper investigation into how this went on for so long. And we've given you instances that have actually happened and red flags that emerged in the last 15 odd years for this man. Actually, more than that, in the last 20 years for this man. And instead of really investigating those links, instead of investigating those charges, instead of keeping him away from crucial roles and postings, every time he actually either got promoted or he got a more important job, a more important responsibility within the Jammu and Kashmir Police, or he got a gallantry award. There is a huge disconnect here, and we need answers for that. How did that go on? Who was protecting him? Who was looking the other way while he went on minting money by helping terrorists? Terrorists! And I also find it a little surprising that this is not a question that everybody tonight is asking. This must concern all of us. A policeman whose job it is to fight militancy and terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir was caught red-handed, ferrying terrorists from Kashmir to the national capital because they were plotting an attack on Republic Day. Let that sink in. There have to be other connections here. There have to be other people involved here. When will we find out about that? It's the big question. We're going to keep a track of this story. Thank you so much. And thank you to all of our panelists for joining us on this conversation.